the millionaires. All right. How many of you here have 1 million in your account?
We don't want to be robbed. We don't want to be robbed. We cannot tell you.
Okay, you think that you are raising your hand. Before I go, I'm a very good. I play football and I watch football. How many of you here are Arsenal supporters? Okay. How many of you are Chelsea supporters? Man City? Barcelona? Okay, which other team? Liverpool? Real Madrid? There are some people who are ready their hand for all the clubs. Okay. In 1988, October 1988, I was on this stage. 1988, I was introduced by a man called B.C. Olatilo. I came from somewhere at the back here. There's a staircase somewhere there, and I've never been there again. I came up, came down the stairs, he called me, I came up here, and the curtains had dropped up to, not up to that point, the curtains had dropped up to this point like this. So I came and I was standing here, 1988, and he introduced me on stage. And it's 30 years after, I'm standing here again. Let me tell you something. No, wait. You see, the passion that you have for anything that you do is one thing that will make anything you want to do succeed. And that passion cannot be driven to a passion until a lot of things are sorted out. For instance, if you say you want to be a footballer, you have to do certain things for it to become a passion. Those things that you have to do for it to become a passion are the things that then convince you to make all the commitments that are necessary for you to become a passion. I explain. If I say I want to become the best footballer in the world, I would have thought of the things I would gain or the things I will achieve, and those things begin to drive my passion. So if you say I want to be fastest person in the world, but you're drinking, you're smoking, you're eating anyhow, and you're putting on weight, by the time you know it, you'll be too big to run against somebody like Usain Bolt, who watches his diet, trains every day, he runs at the beach. So he's running at the beach, he's doing about 8 minutes, 10 minutes for 100 meters on the beach. So when he comes to ordinary ground, he'll run faster. So he's doing that to train himself. When I decided I was going to become a comedian, like some of the people who spoke before me, you would think that it was my graduation exam. Not now that you have comedy videos, books, and everything to read. Then the only thing that I could pick to read from my university there in Ekoma was the Encyclopedia Britannica or Encyclopedia America. You know why? Those were Google at the time. Those were my YouTube at the time. But now you have all of that that you could use. You see, entertainment business is big. And I'm going to talk to you with entertainment generally. Are there any entertainers here? People who want to go into entertainment? Let me see your hands up. Alright? So, let's just do something quickly. Call out the areas of entertainment you want to go into. Artist management, music? What? Production. Music production or television? Television. Cinematography?
Filmmaking.
Okay. Alright?
Animation.
Music. Music education. Film directing. Okay, let me tell you something quick. If you become a comedian and you are good, in less than 1 year, you can buy yourself a 3 million naira car. If you become a comedian and you are very good. If you become a musician and you are very good, you can buy a house in 1 year. If you become a filmmaker and you are very good, you can buy a house and a car in 1 year. If you become a dancer, and you are good at it, you can have a production, stage production, like the type that they have at Terra Culture, in 1 year, and you make a lot of money. The first, as I was telling you, when I stepped here on this stage in 1988, and BC Olatilo then introduced me, BC said something, and he said, this guy here is going to change the face of comedy. This hall was full. There were some noisemakers upstairs. When I say noisemakers, they didn't even want me to say anything. I stood up here, and BC made the mistake of saying, and he comes from Benjamin State University, Ekoma. From up there, they were shouting, Bolo di wa! That was when I did that auto reverse. First time I used the joke of auto reverse. And so we were talking, when I saw the one guy from one corner there said something. I said, you said? The guy said it again. I said, you said? The guy said it again. I said, you said? The guy said, I said, you see? I put him on auto reverse. And everybody laughed. His friends that were there now pushed him forward like, okay. Then I said, Emma Lepe, don't push. They didn't know I was a studio, but I said, Emma Lepe, don't go like a babati. You know, the guy now came down. Oh, God bless me that day. And they gave me a second microphone. You know, when you want to go into any business, learn everything about it. When I decided I wanted to become a comedian, I learned because I was a heckler. A heckler is that kind of guy. You sit down and just continue to throw jabs and make sure that you yab anybody that is on the stage. But, and so I used to do it better. And every time I did that, I get the person that, so when people go for events, they buy me tickets. I say, come and sit by all, come and sit by all. So they can enjoy the show and enjoy your yabbies as well. The first time, Dede Mafia who took me to the shrine, 1988, and I met Fela. Fela was performing, where you have Computer Village now. Fela was performing and performing, and Dede now said, so from where I was throwing yabs, and Fela now said, you believe, wow, city. And then he came, he said, make a yabam. They said, you know, all of them were high on different levels. Make a yabam. They said, yeah, make a yabam. So he said, make a yab. I said, yab me five, then I give you one. That first scattered the place, and then Fela yab me first one, second one, third one, fourth one, enter one, fifth one, enter where they clap. I said, okay, one, just one. So they handed me this mic. They didn't even remove it from the stand. they bent the sand to me like this. So I held him up. I said, Baba, you know, I like you, but as I see you, I see them burn you for public holidays. Some people laugh. Some were like, how actually, because as they burn you for public holiday, nurse is not there to mold the head, they can't get off the head. But I said, Baba, Baba, kill off my head. Fela will be performing, and then he will stop. Bye-bye, public holiday, bye-bye. And then he will continue, and then he will say, I want ya! He will say, who? Carry him outside. And so, it was like my defining moment for yabbed. I became a pro. So what I'm trying to tell you is that, when you want to go into any business, learn about everything. You get some people who become drivers, right? They know when the shock is bad. They know when the brake pad is gone. They know when those are the best drivers. But the one that you be hearing noise, you say, what's that? I don't know. Then you take the car to the mechanic. The mechanic will say, oh, is this thing that needs to be changed? They will bring the bill, you pay. The driver himself does not know. Tire is shaking. Instead of the driver to know his alignment, it's a tire. The owner of the car does not know the difference. There was a lady in Oceanic Bank. Every time she serviced car, she changed headlights. Her driver knew at the time. Every time she serviced it, she would change headlights because somebody told her that it's money. So she serviced the car, she would change it. And then if she has not serviced the headlights, serviced the car and the headlights, when she's driving, if it's nearly 6, she'll be like, I'm going home, I've not serviced my headlights. Somebody has said, service headlights then. He said, every month when I service my car, they say, oh, you don't do your own. And you will run into this, that's what I meant like. And you know what people speak from place of ignorance, they justify it. If there was one car I saw one day like that, the light was on, I knew the person had not serviced his own. Then I said, who? He said, Mukaila. And they were saying, you know, good. So they called Mukaila. Mukaila said, Madame Lo, so we will move my change every month. Now, to entertainment, the kind of money that is entertainment, you can't think about it. In 1996, I got paid my first 1.5 million naira for promoting Saxon Brown. In 1997, I got my first endorsement for Ever Water because I don't drink. Okay, some of you would have known now that I'm brand ambassador for Remy Martin. Have you? I got 125 billboards across Nigeria. And when they paid, my dad knew that I didn't drink. My dad was driving in Warri and saw the billboard. My dad said, people are not people. Because if you are a robo boy in the palace, every time you have this small bottle, glass, and they pour alcohol, every time I'm around, if my dad takes prayers, he passes the others to me. Yeah. As a first son, he will be, me, you drink. If you sit with them in that palace, you'll be dead. Because as people come, they open new schnapps. You know, just and they are there, first son, or para, they want to finish. So my dad will continue passing. And so my dad always notices that every time he gives it to me, I also go and give to either half or any of all those boys. So my dad knew that I didn't like drinking. So when he was okay with being a brand ambassador, forever. Then he saw Remy, no. But I told him how much they paid. He said, it's okay, it's good. But I'm trying to tell you certain things about the money that is in entertainment. Why would Remy Martin pay me close to 5 million naira for 6 months to be brand ambassador? And even give me my age? Because I can't pay for 125 billboards across Nigeria. Run the figures. I have 3 billboards to promote my brand. One in front of Marwa House, which is now Ambode's house, by Marina. I had one at Foshaw Tower, and then I had one where you have Civic Center now, facing the road that comes from 1004. Those three billboards, at the time, 46 sheets cost me 135 naira. The 20 sheets cost me 100,000 naira for 1 year. Now, in 1996, 97, when I did those billboards, it was a lot of money. But what did I do? I put my pager number from Discom at the time, Disc Engineering, pager 197 on the billboards, and I wrote, being funny is serious business. See, whatever talent you have in entertainment, don't consider it a talent until you sell it. Until you sell it, it is just a talent. When you sell it, it becomes a service. Package your talent as a service. That's when you make money from it. If you know how to sing, and you sing from now to tomorrow, until somebody sees value in that singing, it is worthless. So I saw the opening, stand-up comedy. People enjoyed it. I was like, okay. But I did not know how much value it was until Steve Omadafo, he used to own SB Makai. They invited me for one event, 1993. So I went there. I was like, ah, yes, sir. They invited me, talk to my people. So I went to talk. I said, okay, we'll get back to you. They now called me and said, I have this girl, Dolapo. She had back then, telephones, you pay for receiving and pay for. So I had a notebook. This is the other thing that I try to prove. You don't have to own certain things. You can lease. And if you can't lease, you can borrow. But what a lot of people, they want to own. So, if you don't have any big men, I've been crippled by that. Because you've made like 3-4 billion, you buy a plane. And then you now hear of parking fees. And your pilot has to be paid. And every day. Even if it's not flying, you have to pay it. And crew. And by the time you now realize, they say, somebody who has 5 billion now becomes 3 billion. And your pilot is getting richer. So you have to also learn money management if you're coming into entertainment. But the thing that I'm trying to tell you is that ask, if you are a fashion designer, this is your time to benefit from the entertainment industry. Instagram has made it possible for you to blow. You see, this thing I'm wearing now, if you wear something to red carpet and they take a picture of it, that's the end. You have to wear another one. This will cut out if you just about that again.